try to, see, man, here, what I'm trying to convey to you, the man, my message is that we have to reshape what you're, our way of thinking about ourselves and our relationship. And you see there are two questions. Can we die of a broken heart? The short answer is, yes, you can, like Obama, you know, yes, you can die of a broken heart. You can be sure of that. Who's to blame? Mostly us. This is the problem. The long answer is much more complicated. Despite tremendous scientific progress in the last half century, we do not fully grasp the problem of heart disease. Let's start with the classics. John Keats in Auster Nightingale in 1820 said, "My heart aches, and the drowsy mountain pains my senses, as suffer hemlock I drunk." Now, if you legitimately ask yourself, what is this? Is this a description of a heart attack? Yes, it might be, because John Keats studied medicine. But also, he died young, he probably never knew that. So, maybe something about another human disease, just love. What's love to do with all this? You see. We do have a problem. And if someone who complains of having a broken heart, subsequently dies, of heart failure, heart attack, whatever you want. Is it a tragic coincidence or a sign that the body is responding to mental despair? Now this is another way to ask the fundamental question of medicine, the mind-body connection. Which determines which? What was the first, the egg or the hair? Now, the psychiatrist says that to convert something means if you had a psychiatric symptom, you're despaired or whatever, you're depressed or what else you want, you convert it to a physical symptom, a heartache, a stomachache, whatever. So, the psychiatrist says, well, the conversion suggests that when a part of the body acquires some mental significance, it can in some cases become the site of physical illness. Yes, it can. In the European Union, we spend about 110 billion euros annually on medical care for cardiovascular disease. This is a huge problem. And it's not only the disease, it's only the handicap, the infirmity that produces. So, if personality matters in this situation, can we identify the type of person likely to suffer from her problems? This is a legitimate question. And the first answer was what is called the psychosomatic solution. And what's about it? Two cardiologists from San Francisco, very successfully, they had a very intriguing problem. Every few weeks, they had to re-upholster the waiting rooms. Why? The front few centimeters of the seat cushion were very most affected. This edge of your chair, you know? Well, what happened? And the solution came from their furniture. He came and looked, what's wrong with all your patients? They all stay on death. They want to start a competition or something, pushing on that cushion, you know? And maybe they have something in common, all these patients, and say, they find the type A behavior. Now, what kind of guy is this? This is vicious, it's aggressive, it's competitive, it's restless, time urgency. Oh gosh, well, get him, promote him, he might be a very good manager, he will make us rich, this is the best man. Well, the dark side of the moon, like the dark side of the problem, was that these people might die younger. And they found out that heart disease mortality in type A behavior is two times more frequently than a type B behavior, a little more relaxed, more introspective, and so on. Well, it was a great success. We have the extraordinary explanation, everything is clear. No, it's not clear. After 22 years, on the same group of persons, the Western Phlebotomy study found out that there was no difference in mortality between type B and type A. So, meta-analysis made some years later explained that less than 2% of the variation of heart disease can be predicted by the type A behavior, which is no better than other risk factors. So the hypothesis was busted. What is the valid concept? No, it because this is a competent behavior conflict. And some factors like restless, competitive, time urgency are part of many different scales that are used currently in psychology and in medicine. Other factors are clearly associated with conventional personality factors we already know, like neuroticism and extroversion, and it's much easier to evaluate these two. But we did not abandon the concept altogether, because the only predictive factor in type A behavior is hostility. And you look around yourself and you see hostility in buses, in television sets, in politician clashing with others. Everywhere you find a lot of hostility. Hostility independently explains 2% of the variation in peripheral artery disease and ischemic heart disease. And this is a very serious study that was made in Edinburgh, and it was on about 2,000 persons in Scotland. And their discovery is very important. They said that the level of satisfaction of any subject depends on the level of satisfaction of the member of the social network. Now, self-satisfaction along with the health status are collective phenomena. So if you have happy friends, you will be happy sometime later. If you have an obese friend, in 2 years' time, you have a lot of chances to become obese yourself, because it speaks and does only eats and speaks about eating. So they discovered that it was three nodes. If the friend of your friend of your friend is obese, you will, in 2 years' time, you will be obese too. If the friend of your friend of your friend is unhappy and unsatisfied, in 2 years' time, you will be unhappy and unsatisfied, whatever your real situation in life. So, choose your friends. The special solution I've closed with, I'm going to warn you, it was a study that was made in East Finland. We have now a growing problem with dementia. Be it Alzheimer's, Lewy bodies, whatever you want. Dementia as a whole will be a huge burden to our health costs in all Europe and in America and the civilized world. But it seems that we outlive our brains. I think that's a pity. Well, what should we do? Now, what did we discover in this field? That there's a strong association between midlife marital status and cognitive function in later life. The risk of dementia is almost triple for those living below in middle and late life. So, it's better to have an annoying partner than not at all, yeah? Well, at least you can't. And some final questions and answers. Now, do all these studies suggest that there are links between the biological body and the political social community known as the polis? Yes, they suggest so. Most Romanian politicians pretend they never use it for effect. But don't believe them, just judge their facts. They buy foreign property in countries where the polis is very well run. So instead of running responsibly their own communities here in our country, so they are hypocritical, don't believe them. There is an answer, yes, the physical health is related to the way the community is run, so we have to do something to society to heal ourselves. Another question, is the duty of medicine that can be made the best way to run the polis? Well, now it's your turn to answer, it's not my problem. But let's not finish in a gloomy disposition. After all, I don't want to ruin your weekend. So, forget about cholesterol and enjoy staying with your friends. And remember Shakespeare, life are these long. Thank you.